By now, Valve has made it pretty obvious that they're watching the Steam Deck community for ideas on how to make the Steam Deck even better. The upcoming SteamOS 3.5 is just more proof of that because they've now added a vibrancy slider that acts similar to the Vibrant Deck plugin that's already available on Decky Loader. But reports seem to indicate that it's even better than that. So I'm going to talk about that as well as other things that we can expect from SteamOS 3.5 because there are a few major updates on the way in this next big Steam Deck update. But I have a bunch of other stuff to talk about too. I want to talk about the biggest update to Steam Desktop since Big Picture Mode was added. I want to talk about the upcoming roadmap for EmuDeck, even more improvements to Yuzu, and of course some big updates to the ROG Ally situation. So let's get into the smaller stuff and work our way up. What's good, Deck Gang? Let's kick off the Deck News segment with another Humble Bundle. This is a striking Souls-like bundle, and you can get at least 6 deck-verified Souls-like games for $18. I say at least because Humble have already said that there are going to be more games coming soon. These games all have at least mostly positive reception, but there are some major standouts. Loot River and Sands of Aura in particular are a little flawed, but really worth experiencing for yourself, I think. Loot River feels like Diablo meets Souls-likes, and I got really consumed by it for a few weeks. Sands of Aura is still in early access, but it already has like 20 to 30 hours of content. I saw a Steam review that compared it to a Souls-like version of Wind Waker, where the vast ocean is replaced instead by sand, and that seems pretty accurate. Oh, I also want to call out Salt and Sanctuary, which is somehow 7 years old now, but it's a goddamn classic. It's the first game I remember with the 2D Souls-like formula, and it still holds up today. In fact, here's a key for Salt and Sanctuary, as well as Loot River, not to mention a few other games thanks to some awesome viewers. You see, last week I welcomed you all to send keys over if you want me to feature them in a giveaway, and some kind folks went ahead and did that, so shout out to Aaron, Quinn, Marcus, and Cutmeyer. I may have another surprise soon, so stay tuned. By the way, if you do like these giveaways, make sure to leave a like and a comment so I know to keep doing them. Next up are some new ROG Ally updates since last week. Actually, I made an ROG Ally video late last week, expecting very few of you to be that interested, but it low-key ended up being one of my biggest videos on this channel. That's kind of bananas. Anyway, that video was about the leak for the pricing of the Z1 Extreme model of the Ally. According to that leak, we should expect it to come in at $699. And if you recall, the Z1 Extreme is actually the better of the two new AMD APUs. The other one is the Z1, and over the weekend, we got a new leak from Snoopy Tech where he said the Z1 model will be $599. Those two prices don't appear to make much sense together because the value you seem to get for the Z1 Extreme looks like it's worth more than the $100 difference would appear to indicate. I personally expected the Z1 version would be priced closer to $499 if the Z1 Extreme was really going to be $699. Nonetheless, despite Snoopy Tech's reliable leaking thus far, these are still leaks and we have yet to see anything official. I guess we'll have to wait until May 11th. By the way, Linus talked a little bit about what to expect from the Ally on the WAN show, and obviously I haven't touched the Ally myself, but I have plenty of experience with Windows handhelds, and I really do agree with his points. Here's a summary that was posted on Reddit. Shout out to Bruno Marquez BR for posting it, and shout out to my friend Mosquito who shared it with me. Basically, Linus says that if the alleged price of the Z1 Extreme model is true, then it is very aggressive pricing indeed because the Ally has much better performance, and it's also much quieter. He goes on to clarify that it's not a perfect experience by any means, but that games are by and large more compatible than the Steam Deck despite problems that you may sometimes have when you actually go to play the game. In that way, he says that the Steam Deck is more like a console and the Ally is like a computer with a controller, and I agree. Again, I'm going based on my experience with Windows handhelds more broadly, and so if I compare the Aya Neo 2 to the Steam Deck feels like a console and the Neo 2 is much closer to a PC with a controller. Finally, he says that Microsoft needs to get involved for this to become a good experience, and again, I totally agree. There are some great third-party apps out there like Handheld Companion for Windows, but Microsoft could be doing a lot more to make the OS more amenable to being used on a gaming-first machine. Next, there are a bunch of emulation updates you should know about. You may have seen that EmuDeck had its largest update with EmuDeck 2.1. This came with some big UI changes, some new emulators, a USB transfer wizard, a new way to manage emulators, a migrate installation feature, as well as a new cloud services manager that allows you to more easily add those cloud services like Netflix and YouTube to your game mode. They also partnered with Steam RAW Manager to make it much easier to use on the Steam Deck, and I made a video that goes over all the new features and is officially my new ultimate emulation guide, so check that out if you want to. But in addition to launching EmuDeck 2.1, they gave us a little peek into what's coming next. They said they had a roadmap for EmuDeck 2.2, but they're going to keep it mostly secret for now. You can always become a Patreon supporter to get early builds of EmuDeck, but like I said, they at least gave us a little peek, but it's actually a big one. They shared a video that demonstrates the new Save Sync feature, and this looks awesome. They demonstrated it across three different machines, one running SteamOS in desktop mode, one running Windows using EmuDeck Windows Edition, and one running Steam Deck's game mode. They would fire up Mario World in one machine and it would auto-load the most recent save state and they'd shut it down and then proceed onto the next machine and rinse and repeat. They said there's still work to be done on this feature, but I gotta say, it's gonna be amazing to be able to automatically sync saves and save states across different machines. I cannot wait for this feature. Speaking of different machines, the Windows edition of EmuDeck is still in beta, but once the Save Sync feature is more stable, they're going to rename it to EmuDeck WE Early Access to indicate that it's not just a beta anymore. They indicated that they will continue work on an Android version and possibly a macOS version, but that those aren't as highly prioritized as what was otherwise mentioned. These are all very exciting developments all around, and I can't wait to see how EmuDeck 2.2 develops over the coming months. Staying on the subject of emulation, Yuzu continues to see even more improvements, especially related to Breath of the Wild, as we hurtle towards the release of Tears of the Kingdom. At BSOD Gaming made a post about this on Twitter. They said that there were particle issues that were fixed in normal accuracy and that this led to basically a 35% boost in frame rate. That was tested on a presumably beefy desktop, but this sort of boost can be seen on the Steam Deck as well. This is in addition to the other changes I reported on previously that improved the performance and compatibility of Breath of the Wild when running on Yuzu. At the same time that this is happening though, it appears that someone has already gotten their hands on a physical copy of Tears of the Kingdom, and the leak for that may be coming soon, so we may actually hear reports on how compatible the new Zelda is in Yuzu in the next few days. Of course, I'll keep you posted on how that all develops. Alright, so I felt a bit of jealousy when I saw this story, I'm not gonna lie. The Steam Deck launched in Japanese retail stores last week, and it's pretty damn cool. Shout out to Boiling Steam who covered this in depth, I'll leave a link to that in the description. According to them, there were 50 people waiting in line as the store went to open, and there were various Steam Deck posters and ads every few meters on the facade of the store. Once you get in the store, there were these tables that you could sit at to play a demo Steam Deck loaded with games like Tales of Arise, Octopath Traveler 2, and Hades. In fact, the OnDeck JP account on Twitter shared a full lineup that included Ace Attorney Chronicles, Monster Hunter Rise, Death Stranding, Yu-Gi-Oh! Duel Links, Elden Ring, and Bomberman. A diverse cast of games indeed. After trying the Steam Deck, you were able to get a Steam Pal mascot. And listen, I already told you I was jealous, I don't know what more you want from me. Overall, the impressions from the author at Boiling Steam were positive, but they did state that there were some problems like games crashing or not launching properly, and to add to that, people were almost entirely left to their own devices and really weren't provided any assistance. Still, it's fascinating stuff, and I'm glad there were some boots on the floor to give us the skinny, so thanks Boiling Steam. And here are a couple of quick random stories I got for you. First, a post was shared on Facebook of what appears to be a Ukrainian remote controlled machine gun. One of the pictures featured a soldier holding a Steam Deck, implying that the deck is used to remote control the weapon, which is pretty nuts to see, but also makes sense seeing as it is a, you know, computer. Big thanks to Gaming on Linux for sharing that one. And another quick one from last week, Sadly It's Bradley reported that Valve are hiring in some particularly notable roles for virtual reality, specifically a display architect that has a fluent history in OLED/HDR, and a consultant focused on bringing, quote, next-gen Valve indexed products for commercial launch, end quote. Of course, there are Steam and SteamOS updates, as well as a recent interview where Valve confirmed they're definitely continuing to develop VR headsets, so hopefully we hear more soon about a upcoming product launch. Alright, and before we get into SteamOS 3.5, I wanted to talk about the latest Steam client update from Valve. This is easily the biggest update to Steam Desktop since Big Picture Mode, I would say. What do you think? To start, they made some changes under the hood that are going to make it easier to iterate on Steam in the future, especially across different versions that now exist, meaning the desktop client, Big Picture Mode, and Steam Deck. This is going to be important for at least one of the new features that I'm going to talk about, more on that in a moment. Broadly speaking, they've worked hard on refreshing the entire Steam UI to make it more consistent, which is good because the inconsistent UI of Steam has been a running joke for years now. And most importantly, when it comes to UI, they've completely overhauled the in-game overlay. As they put it, there is now more utility and it allows for a lot more customizability. There's a new toolbar that gives you access to anything you may need. It's in the middle of the game and it has friends, chats, achievement progress, guides, discussions, a browser, and more. They said they've picked a couple windows by default and you can pick and personalize the pieces of content that you want to see in your overlay. Furthermore, the settings are actually saved for your games. This toolbar can be switched between an icon view and a list view in the settings. That's all great news, but there's even more. There's now a game overview that serves as your one-stop shop to see what's going on with this game since you last played it. For example, it shows what achievements you have in progress, which friends are playing the same game, top guides, news, and more. And here's one of my favorites, the new Notes app lets you take notes about the game that you're currently playing. It syncs across to your other PCs and it can even be used offline. It's got rich text formatting, not to mention the ability to have multiple notes per game. And this to me is extremely reminiscent of the notebook plugin for DeckyLoader, and I expect to see this come over to the Steam Deck in the next few months, especially now that they've made changes under the hood that will help make it easier to iterate on the different versions of Steam. And get this. The overlay now allows you to pin windows so that they can actually show up while you're still in game. For example, I can pin my notes as well as a guide. I can also pin a discussion or the browser itself. Valve actually points out that you can even watch a movie picture in picture as you're playing your game. That is sick, and I'm curious to see if they add this pinning functionality to the deck as well. Next up, the notifications are now richer and more useful. They tried to make it so that the green light only actually lights up when there's something useful. I also love that they completely refreshed the screenshot manager. It looks pretty good, but I'd like to see screenshots auto-sync to the cloud so that you can manage your screenshots from the mobile Steam app or from another device. Hopefully that's coming soon. Finally, they said that the technical work in this update also makes it possible to enable hardware acceleration for the Mac and Linux versions of Steam, bringing them up to par with the Windows versions. That means snappier animations, scrolling, and more responsive UI. Linux users should already be able to access the new client, but Mac users will have to wait at least a couple of weeks. Speaking of which, this new client is still in beta, so you'll have to opt into the Steam beta if you want to see this. Of course, you can share any feedback and bug reports in the Steam forums as well. One other quick thing here is that someone on Reddit also noticed another update that was possibly unintentional, thanks to user Piccoloid778, who found that you can now launch the soundtrack player for any soundtrack you own inside of Big Picture Mode. It's only kind of half working, so it seems like they meant to keep this locked down for a little longer, but another Reddit user that goes by Carlinux pointed out that, quote, Valve has said that they are working on a complete overhaul of the media system, including the audio stack and the media player in-game and in the Steam Deck UI, so I guess it will improve massively, end quote. Cool stuff. And that brings us to the main topic of today. What is it that we can expect from SteamOS 3.5? Well, SteamOS 3.5 has already been out in the wild for some time now, if you're familiar with the quote-unquote main channel for the Steam Deck. I haven't talked about this much for a few reasons. Number one, it can be a little bit confusing since main channel sounds like the stable channel, but it's actually a hidden channel that you can see when you enable developer mode and then enable the ability to see advanced channels. Which brings me to the second reason I haven't talked about it. This channel is even more unstable than the preview channel and not really intended for public use. But the reason it's come up on Reddit and Discord lately is because there is a new vibrancy slider that Valve has added to this branch of SteamOS. I first saw this on Reddit courtesy of Mosquito, who shared it on the Fan the Deck Discord. This seems inspired by the popular Vibrant Deck plugin that's available on DeckyLoader, though perhaps it's even better because it also works on external displays. I think many of us have already known that Valve watches different channels to see how people are using the deck and what tools people are using to customize their deck in different ways. We saw that people started making their own boot videos and then even simplifying that process even further. And then of course, Valve takes a number of steps to make this all even easier on SteamOS by default, including adding boot video section to the Steam Point Shop. I think this is fairly unique to Valve, but I also think it pays dividends. It helps to see what people actually find useful and what features are popular before you spend too much time working on something that doesn't end up getting used. Likewise, there's a bug fix in the upcoming SteamOS that relates to another long-loved plugin. That, of course, is a fix to the performance bug related to SMT. Here's a description of the bug from Valve's interview with PC Gamer about a month ago. Quote, "It turns out when you have two threads on the same core and one thread is still working on something and the second SMT thread goes to sleep, it throws away its cache using the same logic. So the thread that's running suddenly loses its L3 cache, and in terms of CPU, that's really bad. It kind of has to refetch everything from memory, lots of latency, basically a bubble in computing, and your frame rate goes to shit. So that's what's happening, end quote. That bug was actively hurting the performance of Switch emulation, which is CPU bound on the Steam Deck, and many users were mitigating this by actually disabling SMT altogether on the Deck with the help of the Power Tools plugin. This fix, which is available now in SteamOS 3.5, means you don't need to disable SMT in order to get the most out of Switch emulation on the Deck. Once again, another way that Valve is watching the community and using that as a way to fuel iteration and improvement on the Deck. And the final big update to SteamOS 3.5 that I wanted to mention was HDR. I've said a few times that this feature is close to launching, and Reddit user NexiPal confirms that HDR plus HDR10PQ support is now available, in addition to better color management in general. All in all, this marks four features where Valve borrowed from the community: custom boot videos, Vibrant Deck plugin, Power Tools, and a notebook plugin. And that made me want to ask, how else do you want to see Valve borrow from the community? I personally have three major features I would like to see. The first has to be Decky Recorder, which is another Decky Loader plugin. Decky Recorder has shown us that we can record clips on a Steam Deck without a huge cost to the Steam Deck's responsiveness. This even works retroactively, where Decky Recorder can record the last 30 seconds of gameplay using Steam and Start. This one is a no-brainer if you ask me. And next up is Decky Cloud Save. I actually haven't tried this plugin, but it's supposed to be a cloud save solution for games that don't support Steam Cloud. I can't report to you how well it works, but I think that Valve should absolutely implement a way for me to sync my non-cloud saves. I would go as far as to say that I'm willing to pay money for this as part of some premium set of features. Finally, I'll add Cryo Utilities. CryoByte 33 has a suite of utilities on the Steam Deck that are mostly set it and forget it. These help improve performance in some scenarios, and as far as we know, have not led to any degradation in performance or compatibility in any other scenarios. Hopefully Valve is looking at this and considering it too. All right, and the last thing I wanted to mention for today is a game called Horoscopicus. The developer of this game reached out and asked if I wanted to share it with my viewers. I gave it a shot and decided that yeah, I sure did. So here's the deal. He gave me 15 keys to give away, and those are on screen now. But yeah, try it for yourself and let me know what you think. For me, this was a really fun and charming 2D action platformer. It has a Game Boy Color aesthetic to it. For the gameplay itself, it's simple but fun and challenging. Kind of reminds me of Mega Man, especially because you can choose your own path, which affects which power-ups you get first. And as I mentioned, it can be challenging, but it is short, and there's an assist mode if you want to make sure that you see everything that the game has to offer. Finally, it works well on Steam Deck, so yeah, check it out. If you didn't get a key, maybe pick it up since it's already inexpensive, or perhaps add it to your wishlist for next time. All right, Deck Gang out. Goodbye.